but yet it needs to be said. Because this public demonstration of disagreement and criticism of an order that we don't agree with is necessary. Without being able to express these things, there is little space left for any kind of disagreement or dissent in the future. I think many things happened. Again, as Shabnam had said, I would not go into the nitty-gritties of the judgment, but I just want to begin by counting something that we reported in the caravan. The day before the judgment came out, one of our young reporters, Shahid, a photographer and a reporter from Kashmir, went and attended a meeting called at the Teenmurti by Krishna Gopal, RSS leader.
The very fact that Teenmurti itself had become hostage to what are basically political meetings by the RSS is the kind of institutional demolishment that is a continuation of what happened at Babri in some senses symbolizes, that the Teenmurti could be used so easily. What was that gathering at Teenmurti? It was a gathering where the RSS was addressing sympathetic Muslim voices to prepare them for the verdict, which they were pretty sure would be in their favor. What Shabnam says is testified to by in that story that the RSS had prepared for days, weeks and months in advance in the anticipation that the verdict will be in their favor. Now it is not up to me to decide why they were so sure that such a verdict will come in their way, but they certainly expected the ethos of the country where we stand today led them to be fairly confident that this is the verdict we will see on that day. I just want to, from the story, quote something that a prominent, and I want to get the words right because I want to emphasize this, Soheb Kasmi, leader of the JUH, a Muslim organization floated, which is affiliated to the Sangh Parivar, told a reporter, Supreme Court ki kya aukaat hai yaar sarkar ke samne. This he said on record in the meeting, we have quoted it. The next day when the story appeared, a lawyer affiliated with the RSS told us this is contempt, that he will take us to court. I said, feel free. We will defend this. This was stated there. We have the evidence to actually back this up. Nobody has taken us to court. This was stated at with that meeting, with Krishna Gopal presiding at that meeting, where many sympathetic Muslim intellectuals were prepared for what was to come. The judgment itself, I will just basically say two things about the judgment that are of concern to me, which is simply that I call it the Babri verdict. The use of the term repeatedly, the Ayodhya verdict, is to deny a truth of the site. The Babri verdict distinguishes between two things: the historical reality of a mosque and the mythic belief in a personality. And it places myth and history on equivalent footings and gives primacy to myth on the name of some understanding of faith. It gives primacy to faith, and then through this whole judgment, at no point does it tell us on what basis is primacy being given to myth. Is there any evidence that Ram was a historical personage? Does the judgment ever want to inquire into this fact if they want to establish? No, they take it for granted that the faith of the believer is an appropriate instrument for rendering justice or deciding what is right or wrong. I just, in that context, want to say something which goes a little wider than the judgment. Why have we reached this point? There is, apart from the current climate, there is a reflection, a confusion about what religion and its role in our public space. We keep talking of where religion fits in our public space. We keep asking questions about our secularism. Actually, that definition is rather clear, but we ourselves, all of us, participate in this confusion. We tend to often equate the idea of secularism with Sar Dharm Sambhav. I'm sorry, but it is not a sentiment I am comfortable with. Where the sambhav of a dharm conflicts with constitutional morality. It is constitutional morality that has to take precedence. In such a situation, there is no sambhav of dharm that is possible. I am a little tired of the terms that we constantly use, that we must rely on the good Hindu, the good Muslim, the good Sikh. I will take a bad Hindu, a bad Muslim, a bad Sikh, who is a good citizen, any day over a good Hindu, a good Muslim, or a good Sikh. Our constitutional morality asks one thing, that in terms of the question of public morality, the public ethics we display, it is the constitution that must take precedence over the deepest faith any believer may genuinely have. We have to accept this and state this very clearly. This is the very basis of this republic. It may allow space for faith, but unfortunately, the duties of a good Sikh, a good Muslim, or a good Hindu, or a good Christian, I am not specifying any religion here, in terms of the argument with a good Hindu over the Babri verdict, we may hear that my faith makes me believe that there was a temple here. Often people will say that, you know, but a good Hindu would not want the demolition of a mosque. I'm sorry, you can go back and find many justifications from the huge canon of epics within Hinduism which would justify certain actions, even if they are deviant from the morality of what we think. There is no defined morality which will define the conduct of a good Hindu. For that matter, I can say the same thing about scripturally a good Muslim or a good Sikh. In the end, why that act was wrong was because it was against the constitution, and that is what the judgment fails to realize or depend on when it raises these questions. That the idea of a faith, and here I come back to the fact that in our country, whatever belief systems we have, we are richer for the diversity of our faiths. We are richer for the interaction between our faiths. And we must celebrate the syncretism, but syncretism and faith are no defense of how this country needs to run. That only relies on the constitution. I come from a faith, I'm not a believer, I'm a bad religious person in every way. I do believe in the ideas of the constitution, a good citizen. But in our country, the idea of public spaces governed by the morality of a religion is a dangerous idea, and often we have succumbed to it, and we have often tried to read our secularism in this light to our own detriment, to our own danger. So I just want to end that this judgment, which is the manifestation of the current ethos, is something we have prepared grounds for in our misunderstanding of where religion should actually stand in terms of public life. We must celebrate our syncretic culture, but we must not rely on it to deliver constitutional justice. As I was going to say, and I want to end with that, yes, I come from a faith that is syncretic, where the hymns of the gurus, which derive both from Sufi, Muslim, and Hindu influences from the Sants, are sung every day in households. It does not stop the Sikhs often enough from being as fundamentalist as the rest of the community. The violence of partition, what we saw through the years of terror in Punjab. Every community, despite whatever their ethos is, all the syncretism, all the good faith is not going to protect us or stand in our way. And this is where the judgment errs over and over again. Constitutional morality has to be defended, and that morality must put faith in its place. Push it out of public spaces where it wants to seek preeminence over what our constitution has decreed. And that is what the judgment has failed to do. That is what we often ourselves fail to do when we engage in public with these questions. Thank you.